In general, every mechanical system has a stiffness behavior due to which, when we apply some force on it, the system in response tries to either deform or move or do a combination of both. The stiffness that we refer to here is not just of a particular material or part, but rather for the full assembly, which includes all other physical features such as the geometries of the parts, the way they are interacting with each other, the materials that they are made up of, and any other factor that may affect the overall stiffness. The relation between this applied external force and the resultant displacement is referred to as a system response. Take this spring mass system as an example. In this case, the dead weight is the applied external force, and in response, the spring deforms until it starts supporting the weight of the block. If the spring stiffness remains constant throughout this deformation, then we can see a linear force displacement response. So this system can be assumed to be a linear system. Now, let's consider the same system, but attach a dead weight which is, say, 10 times heavier than the previous block. Now, the spring stiffness may start to change at large displacements, and as a result, the spring response is no longer linear. So this makes it a nonlinear system. In reality, this relationship between the force and displacement is nonlinear for most systems. But depending on the magnitude of the applied forces and the inherent properties of the system, this relation may be closer to a linear nature. For such cases, the relationship can be idealized as a linear response, so it can be solved more efficiently using linear solvers. However, it's not always possible to make such an idealization. In fact, there are many applications where such an idealization is either not possible or it may result in inaccurate predictions. Take, for example, crashworthiness studies, which are very crucial in studying the occupant's safety in the event of a car crash. In this example, the car structure deforms significantly, and there are many parts moving and deforming in tandem, which makes it a highly nonlinear system. In such a case, it's not possible to reduce it to a linear system. Similarly, take example of head impact studies, which are now becoming very useful in studying traumatic brain injuries that are occurring in various scenarios, including sports or car accidents. In these studies, it's important to know how the stress wave is traveling through the brain tissue and deforming it in due process. Due to its inherent soft and complex nature, the brain tissue material is nonlinear. Neglecting this material nonlinearity will result in inaccurate predictions of tissue deformation, which in turn will result in dangerously inaccurate safety standards. So the question arises as to when can an engineer make such simplifying assumption without losing the relevance of their analysis? This is not a simple question to answer, but there are few guidelines which provides the wisdom to the engineer so they can make an informed decision when posed with such a question. The engineer must identify what introduces nonlinearity in the model to be able to decide whether a nonlinear solver is needed. In general, there are three key factors that can change the stiffness behavior of the system and introduce nonlinearity. These are large deformations, contact nonlinearity, and material nonlinearity. Often, these factors appear in combination, in which case the nonlinearity becomes more apparent and makes it an easier decision to take. In this section on introduction to nonlinearities, how about we make this question central to our discussion? We'll talk about the different sources of nonlinearity in the model response, and how exactly do they make a system nonlinear? This discussion will be helpful in identifying when a system should be treated as nonlinear, or when is it more forgiving to idealize it as a linear system.